meeting and training to order, and whenever our presenters are ready, we're ready to start too.
Okay, John had to go print his notes.
Okay.
And he's.
All right, well, we'll get underway here. John and Krista are representatives from the Wisconsin Freedom of Information Council. We have a couple of brief presentations and then generally open it up for question and answers from the council and the public. And so that's all I have in the way of introductions. So go ahead, John.
Well, thank you very much for inviting us here tonight. This isn't something that happens often. We are at the council trying to do more outreach, and you guys have provided us with an excellent example of that. I'm John Faust, a public board member of the Freedom of Information Council, and this is attorney Krista Westerberg of Pinesbach from Madison, and she's the council's co-vice president. Krista will be speaking first about open meetings, and then I'll speak about open records. And after that, we'll spend as much time as you like on questions and answers. But first, a little bit about the Freedom of Information Council. Our bylaws say that the purpose of the council is to safeguard the right of the public to the information it must have to act responsibly in a free and democratic society, and to monitor the climate in which state journalists must fulfill their obligation to society. Government conducted in the open benefits the public interest. So to that end, we watch for changes in the open records and open meetings laws. We watch for changes that come from court cases that test those laws. And we watch for changes in the way that government, from the state down to the smallest subcommittee and board, carry out those laws in actual practice. And when we see changes that are good, we applaud them. And when we see changes that aren't so good for government transparency, we speak out. Now, if you ever attended one of our quarterly meetings, you'd see a room full of current or retired newspaper editors, reporters from the major papers around the state and the wire services, investigative journalists from newspapers and from television, a few attorneys, maybe someone from the Department of Justice, a UW journalism professor, or two, probably a few political operatives from organizations at opposite sides of the aisle. But on that afternoon, perhaps they'll be sitting next to each other and cheerfully chatting. If you're looking for a working example of people of all stripes who are united by a common interest and working together, please look to our council. We all believe in the importance of government transparency. Now, you might know the council from our monthly Your Right to Know column that appears in newspapers throughout the state. And Krista has written many of those. That column's another form of outreach that we've done for many years. We've been around for almost 40 years. But last spring, we did a 9-city roadshow giving presentations like this, including a stop in Janesville. And maybe some of you went to that. So with that, I'll introduce Krista, and she'll start talking about open meetings.
Thank you, John, and hello, everybody. I'm Krista Westerberg. I'm an attorney at Pinesbach Law Firm in Madison, and as John mentioned, I'm co-vice president of the Wisconsin Freedom of Information Council. I've been with the council about 10 years or so, and I'm here to talk about open meetings. Two primary laws in Wisconsin guarantee our public right to know, the open meetings law and the public records law. Both of them start with the same preamble, which is that there is a presumption in favor of openness. We start with the idea that a meeting is open and that a record is available to the public. And I printed the whole preamble of the open meetings law on this slide because it is so important. I won't read the whole thing, but the idea is that representative government is dependent upon an informed electorate So we have to have as much information as possible. Open government fundamentally is about democracy. We can't do our job as citizens unless we know what's going on. And that's why we have this presumption in favor of openness that is in bold there at the end of the slide. And the Wisconsin Supreme Court has said that this is one of the strongest statements of policy in the entire Wisconsin statutes. It's also important because if there's a close case, this presumption of favor of openness is the tiebreaker, and where, you know, the arguments could be on one side or another, maybe something should be open or closed. This breaks the tie, and we have an open meeting. Entities subject to the open meetings law are governmental bodies, and that includes city councils like this one, boards, commissions, committees, public bodies that are organized by statute and constitution. But the important thing about that is that it's a governmental body. It's not an individual government employee. They can't typically meet with themselves. This applies to meetings and entities that get together and meet. There's an interesting case that was just argued before the Wisconsin Supreme Court last week about whether a school district's curriculum committee is subject to the open meetings law. And so that'll be an interesting one to see how that turns out. What's a meeting? Well, you have to have a governmental body with a purpose to do governmental business, a quorum, and a quorum, so a sufficient number of people to get together to make a decision for the body. That can actually be less than a majority of the body. Say you have a decision that a city council has to make by a two-thirds vote. One-third of those people would be sufficient to make a decision on the issue. And so that can be a meeting, even if you don't have a majority of the body there. Sometimes there can be meetings that occur electronically. There are some attorney general opinions that say if a city council is on an email chain and everyone is kind of rapid fire writing each other, that can be a meeting. There can also be what are they called, walking quorums. So if a member of a governmental body goes and talks to all of the other members individually and they make a decision about something or get information, that can also be a meeting. But mostly you have to have the purpose to engage in governmental business and a sufficient number of people to decide the outcome of some issue. So if the open meeting law applies, what does that mean? There's three basic requirements. There has to be advance notice of the meeting, typically at least 24 hours. The meeting must be held in a place that is reasonably accessible to members of the public. And the meeting must be open to the public unless there is a specific exemption to the open session requirement that applies. So I'll go through those in turn here. Notice for a meeting, whether it's open or closed, has to include the time, date, and place of the meeting so people know where and when to go. And they also should also describe the subject matter of the meeting in such form as is reasonably likely to apprise members of the public and the news media thereof. So people have to know where and when the meeting is and what's going to be discussed. As to that subject matter requirement, what does that mean? Well, you've got a reasonably apprised member of the public, which you figure that out at the time the meeting is noticed. And you look at, you know, you don't want to write War and Peace in your meeting notice and make it so long that it's a huge pain for the governmental body to write it or for the public to read it. But you look at the burden on the, in this case, let's say city council of providing the notice and making more specific information available. You look at the degree of public interest in the subject matter. If you have something that's a really controversial issue, you probably want to be a little bit more specific in your notice because people are going to be interested in it. They might not know to be looking for it. And so you want to be more specific in that situation. And that gets to that last bullet point too, whether the subject of the meeting is routine or novel. If people are expecting your city council to have a budget update every month, you probably don't need to be as specific as if you were writing about something that was completely new. And that all comes from a case 10 years ago now, called Buswell versus Tolma Area School District. There is an additional requirement for the notice if you have a closed session meeting. You not only have to say what the subject of the closed meeting is, but what specific provision of the open meetings law allows the governmental body to meet in closed session. And I'll give you an example that might hit a little bit close to home. There was a case that we did about 10 years ago involving the city of Milton, and the notice for those meetings simply said, we're going to meet in closed session to discuss the industrial park. But what was really discussed was the purchase of property for and development of a contract for a new ethanol plant, which is, I think, not too far away from here, if I'm not mistaken. And that was something where the city or the court said, yeah, there needs to be more specific notice of that agenda item, because people are not going to be as likely to understand that that is being discussed if you just say industrial park. That's a pretty controversial, novel issue. So let me give you what an example of a sufficient notice would be. This was from that case I mentioned a minute ago, the Buswell versus Toma Area School District case. The notice for the meeting, school board meeting in that case said, new business, consideration and or action on the following TEA employee contract approval. And what was actually happening at the meeting was that the school board was considering the Toma Education Association union contract when we had those. And it also included a controversial contract provision regarding hiring coaches. But the court said, you know, that's enough. I will note there was a dissenting justice on that. But the majority of the court said that's okay. There was another notice that was contested in that case where they were meeting in closed session. You can see the language was pretty general. We're going to get together and consider and maybe take action on employment and negotiation with district personnel. But what they really did was approve that master contract with the teachers union, including this controversial provision about hiring coaches. And that was not sufficient. So that's notice, briefly. Another requirement of the open meetings law is that a governmental body must usually meet in open session. And that's, note that that's open session, you know, that's not just for getting together and discussing decisions. It's for formal and informal action, whether you're gathering information, you're making decisions, all of that is considered governmental business. If you want to meet in closed session, governmental body has the burden to show why an exemption to open session is justified, and any exemptions are strictly construed. There's about 10 of them listed in the statute. Here's a few of them. Some employment-related information can be discussed in closed session, deliberating or negotiating the purchase of public properties, investing in public funds, and conducting other specified public business. When competitive or bargaining reasons require a closed session, that can be okay. Some judicial and quasi-judicial deliberations, some meetings where the reputational interests are going to be discussed. Then there's a few little oddball ones in there, like that I didn't list, but like discussing the location of a burial site. It's okay to go into closed session for that. Important thing is that the list of reasons that you can meet in closed session in the law is exhaustive. You can't make up reasons the legislature hasn't already said are okay. Some reasons that are not okay are if you're negotiating with a developer, if they want to have confidentiality, that's not okay. It's got to be the city's interest or the government's interest to have confidentiality, not a private entity's. If you just are meeting in closed session to avoid acrimonious public debate, not okay. Contentious issues are those most in need of public discussions, as the courts have said. Again, so anything that's not specifically listed in the law is not okay. All right, meeting location. This seems like it would be obvious that you have to meet in a place such as this that's reasonably accessible to members of the public. This maybe becomes more of an issue when you have like a small town board that doesn't necessarily have its own meeting hall, and they want to get together in the town board chair's living room, you know? But, you know, nonetheless, the meeting has to be in some place that's accessible, typically handicap accessible. It's got to be the right size to accommodate the crowd you're expecting. You know, kind of common sense stuff. What not to do. This is one of my favorites. There was actually a case about 10 years ago where, you know, sometimes a city council or a town board or whatever will want to go and look at a development in another town so they know what to expect when that same development is proposed in their town. This has happened a lot with gravel pits, with ethanol plants, with wind farms. We've seen city councils or town boards or whatever, planning commissions, wanting to go take a tour and see what one of these things looks like. So in 2008, the Department of Justice actually had to write a letter to somebody to say, it's not okay for a planning commission or town board, I can't remember what it was, to go visit a gravel pit in a car together, so the public can't listen to the conversation. And then once they get to the gravel pit, they cannot just drive along at slow speeds with the windows rolled down with any member of the public who is interested walking outside of the car. That does not count as a reasonably accessible place, meeting place for the public. Try to visualize that for a second. That actually happened, and the state had to say that that is not okay. And the important point on that too is that those site visits are meetings, and they have to be noticed and accessible. Videotaping and recording meetings. The open meetings law said, it's not exactly in the open meetings law, but it's in the statute. Whenever a governmental body holds a meeting in open session, it's got to make reasonable accommodations for anyone desiring to record, film, or photograph the meeting. You can't be disruptive, you know, make a lot of noise with your equipment and be a total nuisance, but anyone who's sitting there quietly recording, there's no problem with that. And then the governmental body has to accommodate it. That's the open meetings law in a nutshell. Couple of resources if you are interested in learning more. Number one is the Wisconsin Freedom of Information Council website. We not only have information about the council, but also we've posted form open records requests that you can adapt for your own requests. We've got formal and informal letters and opinions of the Attorney General. We've got all of our monthly Your Right to Know columns archived quite a few years back. We've got links to other resources. So it's a really good resource, the Wisconsin Freedom Information Council website. The council, as John was saying, meets quarterly. Our meetings are open to the public. You can always friend us on Facebook. We post updates and news stories about open government issues there frequently. And so that's a good clearinghouse for that kind of information. Another good resource would be the Wisconsin Department of Justice Office of Open Government. They have on their website a public records and open meetings compliance guide and also a helpline for seeking open government advice about the open records and meeting laws specifically. And you see the number there if you're interested in calling, 608-267-2220. It's a unique thing that Wisconsin law says that anyone in the state, any citizen, can call our Attorney General's office or write and ask for advice about how the open records and meetings laws are applied in a particular case. A lot of states have ombudsmans and things like that, but Wisconsin puts that job in the Department of Justice. So they're a good resource. They might take a little bit of time to get back to you depending on their caseload, but eventually they will. And then the state Bar of Wisconsin also has a book called the Public Records and Open Meetings Handbook, now on its fifth edition, and that has a lot of good information about how the open records and meetings laws work. So I would suggest checking those out. And do you want me to take questions on the meetings law now, or should we just save them all for the end after? Save them all for the end. All right, we'll let John go and talk about the open records law. Once he gets his PowerPoint pulled up.
Even though I'm in IT, I have to figure this out. Just a moment. There we go. I'm going to start with a little bit of history trivia. I know I've been driving through Milton for many years, and I know you're a community with a sense of history, and you think about those who have gone before. I remember the plywood outlines along the main drag here. Wisconsin had the nation's first open records law. Soon after we became a state, by 1849, we had this law on the books that said that every sheriff and clerk of the circuit court and register of deeds, and every treasurer and clerk of the board of supervisors in a county, had to keep their offices open 6 days a week for inspection by anyone. Another little bit of trivia I spotted today when I was putting this together, down in the fine print of the bottom of who published those 1849 summary of the statutes, was Christopher Sholes, who was the inventor of the typewriter 10 years later. And another bit of history is that this law was first tested by someone in Jefferson. The clerk of the circuit court there, Walter Besley, back in 1853, he billed the county board $22 for the wood that he used to heat his office and the candles that he used to illuminate it in order to allow the public to come in and inspect the books. The board refused to pay, and he sued them, and the county appealed it, and the Supreme Court ruled in Walter's favor, affirming that necessary function of government to provide that access to records, and that survives to today. And so here's the start of the open records law. As Krista said, these are among the strongest demonstrations of policy that you'll find in the statutes, and that guides court decisions. Now, what is a record first? I like this statute because it's very future-proof. When they revised it a few decades ago, they included computerized information, but before that, it was certainly photographs and things that were handwritten and things that were typed and things that were duplicated. So even though the statute hasn't changed much, court cases do test and define and refine the law, and so this description holds true even in the days of Twitter and Facebook and text messages. If you're writing something down, it's a record. And it will become something that could be considered that someone could request. So some examples of things that aren't records. Now, some of the things I'm going to be talking about are undoubtedly going to be of most interest to elected officials, appointed officials, public employees. But then there's also the public. And you need to know what records are and what isn't a record so that you can make proper record requests. They need to think about what's records, what are records and what aren't, so that they can fulfill your requests. So if you were a public official and you were at a meeting and you took your own personal notes, that's not a record. That's just for your own use. If you were working on a draft of something for an upcoming meeting, or if your secretary was working on something for an upcoming meeting, that can still be considered not a record because it's in progress as a draft just for you or for your purposes. And if you've got a picture of your sweetheart in your office, if you have other personal materials of your own that aren't related to your office, that personal material is not a record either. Now, I tried to summarize this in an informal fashion about what is a record. If you did it on state equipment, if it's related to your official duties and business, if you're talking about something that you're working on, it's probably fair game for someone to request. Now, that draft, as I said, could be worked on by your secretary, a subordinate who reports directly to you. And often in many of these cases that the courts have illuminated for us, the moment that you take something and hand it to someone else, it becomes, it crosses a line and becomes more of something that's less personal and more a record. Now, writing the word draft on something is not a magic spell that protects it. As I said, if you hand it to someone else, if you begin to use that document for the purpose that it was intended to convey some information to someone else, it becomes a record. Now, who does this apply to? It certainly applies to the records that are kept by elected officials in the course of what you're doing. It can apply to appointed officials. Now, it certainly applies to employed public servants, but I like to think about the least person that it applies to. So if you're a citizen you feel that you're doing your civic duty, and you raise your hand to be appointed to the subcommittee of the school board to decide which plants are going to be part of the landscaping at the edge of the new playground, you are an appointed official. You're a member of that committee, and as you talk about the landscaping for the playground, you could be creating records that someone else could request. The open records and open meetings laws, I think they do a good job of also trying to close loopholes. And one of the loopholes that they close is subcontracting. If the government does something, certainly the records you create are subject to possible request. But if you hand off a duty to another organization, be it a nonprofit, let's say, to handle public health issues or public safety issues, or if you subcontract a function of economic development to another organization, you have a contract, it describes what you're looking for from them. The records that subcontractor creates in the course of doing that work, in the public interest, in the task that you assign them to do, those become records that you may be asked to supply as well. Now, back to the public side of things. Open records requests, they can be anonymous. You do need to be specific about what you're looking for. If you make a very open-ended request, it could be denied for that reason. There aren't any specific forms that you need to use. There aren't any magic words that you need to utter. You can make a very specific request for the things that you're looking for, and we would all certainly hope that you're going to make them to the right person. So if you're looking for some city record, you would certainly go to a city clerk. If it were a little less clear, the chairperson of a committee would certainly know who could supply you with the record if they wouldn't do it directly themselves. You can ask to get a copy of a record, and you can ask to simply inspect a record. Now, if you ask to get a copy of a record and it's a paper record or a photograph, audio recording, there's going to be some cost involved in duplicating that for you. And so you can always think about just simply inspecting a record. And there's been some interesting tests in court cases regarding personal photography. Instead of having to pay 25 cents, 50 cents, a dollar per page that they might want to charge you for a copying cost, you can certainly take pictures of them with your cell phone and be able to read the documents that way and not incur any copying charge. back to the government side of these open records requests, that person who's handling the request, please keep in mind that the motive behind that person's request really shouldn't be questioned. If someone did have a conflict and you did not supply a record that they thought they should have access to, and they could show that you were somehow capricious or malicious in your denial because you questioned their motives, you could be found to be in the wrong for that. So you, except for a few circumstances where there's private information, medical records, legal prohibitions for certain kinds of law enforcement records, or sex crime offenders, there are a few situations where you do need to consider the identity of the person making the request and whether they can legally see that record. But in most cases, the request really can be anonymous. If someone steps up to the city clerk and says, I want to see the agenda of this subcommittee meeting, you don't need to ask them their name. You don't need to ask them why they're asking it or why they're asking for it. Yes, there can be costs involved with copying, as I said, and if the costs cross a certain line, you can ask for that payment in advance before you would provide the records. You can charge for the copies. You can charge for the search if the search goes beyond the normal extent of effort that it might take to find something. Certainly these days, searching for particular electronic records, if someone came in and asked for emails that contained certain magic keywords, and there had to be a great effort of searching some mail server somewhere to find all of the emails that could possibly be considered in response for that request, that could take a lot of time and have some actual costs behind it. And you can pass those on to the requester. There can also be a step that, or there is always a step that you can take in, that the government needs to take in determining if the record can be released and if there is any sensitive information in there. The compliance guides that Krista mentioned, certainly all of the material that you've received in training in your official capacities, if you're a city clerk, you've learned about the four-step process and the balancing tests and the reasons that you can deny open records requests. There is also the possibility of redaction. You can print out something and black out information that might turn out to be personal. For example, if I were a government official and I sent out an email to someone that had a bunch of official business and then some personal info that perhaps would be judged to not to be released, that information could be blocked out. As a government official, you need to respond to an open records request as soon as practicable and without delay. Now, the law doesn't have a hard time period on how quickly they can get back to you. The Department of Justice might wave their hands and say the best practice should be that you should certainly respond within at least 10 working days. If you're having some trouble finding the record, you should certainly put it in writing and send it to the requester, give it to the requester to affirm that you're working on their request and that you're going to get back to them. Again, for some of those reasons that your records request might be denied, the simplest is that the record that you're requesting doesn't exist. You can't make a request to create a new record that would involve creating a new record. So if you asked for, let's say, the top 10 list of who has the greatest expense reports within the city, well, if there isn't a record that already looks like that top 10 list, the city is not required to create that top 10 list for you. There, as I said, there are some things that are, that the courts have legally prohibited that could be released to you. There is some extra consideration given, for example, if the record was about you as opposed to someone else, you certainly have a little bit more access to your information about yourself than you would have for other people. And then I mentioned this balancing test where the records custodian at City Hall, let's say, they do have to balance in the question of some records, they do have to balance the strong public interest that we have in disclosing records and making records available to you against the public interest that favors non-disclosure. So you see that in, for example, in open meetings law, where they have they're allowed to go into closed session, for example, to discuss their negotiating strategy for the purchasing of a property, for example. It's not in the public interest for the city to give away its negotiating strategy. The rest of the discussion should be public, but there are some things that are allowed to be secret. And when you make that balancing test and you might come up with a reason to deny the release of a record, you really do need to give specific policy reasons. Embarrassment is not an excuse to not hand out a record, for example. Now, if you were, let's say, that person who volunteered for the landscaping committee of the school board, and you were faced with a request, please remember that you can always turn to the people who are there to help you with that request. If it's something super simple, if it's something that you know has already been released to the public, I would say yes, you do have that personal authority to go ahead and hand someone a copy of the agenda that was already publicly posted, for example. There's no question about that. If you have any question at all, though, there is undoubtedly a records custodian at City Hall that you could turn to, a records custodian at the county or the school district or the other government entity that you volunteered for. And if necessary, they can talk to the attorney and work through the process, help you find the records, help you think about what might need to be redacted in the records, and then to talk about how those records could be turned over to the person who requested them. Now, again, back to the citizen side of open records requests. If you had a complaint, if you thought that you had requested something and you believe it should have been turned over to you, you feel aggrieved, you feel like there's been some injustice, you do have remedies. You have three remedies under the law. One, you can file a open records or an open meetings complaint to your local district attorney. At their discretion, they can respond to you. They might simply say, I don't want to have anything to do with this. They might say, I have a conflict of interest here. It might be in the public interest to investigate this. I'm going to hand it to a district attorney in a nearby county who would handle it. But again, it's at that district attorney's discretion as to whether they help you. There is no requirement that they help you. Similarly, you can make a complaint to the state attorney general's office. They have assistant attorneys general as well. And they might decide to help you, or they might decide to refer you to someone else. They might decide to point you at a resource that might answer your question. The attorney general also provides opinions in some cases. That is a letter that sort of explains their interpretation of what the law might be in that situation. And you might get some relief or in the form of an answer that way. The last step is the one that takes your complaint to the court. It is a special type of filing that certainly costs money for you to hire an attorney. You can do it yourself, although that's rarely recommended. What you're doing is asking the court to force the government to do its job. And you need to follow the same laws and rules that everyone else is looking at. You need to provide your explanation of why the government didn't do its job in this case and that the court should look into it. And so when you see this action is most often taken by people who have bigger, deeper pockets. Newspapers, when they request a record and are refused, they're the ones who will file suit to ask the court to intervene to get that record for them so that they can write a story. Krista provided some of these same resources. I'm going to have my own reminder of what you can find on the Freedom of Information Council website. We have a sample open records request to show you a template to help you fill in what you should provide to a records custodian. I know I said that there were no magic words necessary, and that those custodians will generally help you try to find what you're looking for, but it doesn't hurt to use a few phrases that show what that you know the law and that you know what you're looking for. We have our right to know columns that we provide every month to the newspapers, and we have a big archive of those. We have a discussion of the Watchdog Awards. Every year we get together with another group and highlight the best and the worst of open records and open meetings events that have happened in the preceding year. If you are a citizen who's has done an extraordinary job of testing the law or showing that you were correct in your open meetings and open records violation, you might win our Opie Award, for example. We have a list of frequently asked questions about these open records and open meetings issues. As I said, you know, we are an organization that likes to tell people about the way things should be. We have a list of things that we wish the legislature would do and areas that they would clarify in the law. We have a list, similarly, of problem areas that we see in open government. And we do have a few of those key opinions of the Attorney General that can help provide some guidance apart from court cases, apart from the statutes themselves. I mentioned that we had done a traveling roadshow last year. If you go to wisi.org, Wisconsin I, which is the nonprofit that records government actions and political events around the state, and search for the keywords open government, you'll find the archived video of the open government traveling roadshow that was recorded in Waukesha. And yes, if you think about it, I'm being recorded right now. I'm doing a PowerPoint that has a screen grab of another video of me doing another PowerPoint. You can follow us on Twitter. You can like us on Facebook. And that way you'll find out about those Your Right to Know columns within a few hours after Krista writes one. And if you Google the phrase Wisconsin Public Records Law Compliance Guide, you'll get to that open records guide that the Department of Justice has written and that they do update every few years. In this case, the open records guide is about 90 pages. About 30 pages of that is a copy of the law itself and a compendium of some court citations. So you can skip the last 30 pages and just read the first 60. And then Krista also mentioned the open meetings helpline that the Department of Justice does. So now I will open it up to questions for Krista and I about open records and open meetings.
And the only comment I would make about the questions, since we are recording this and for the sake of being able to hear the questions for folks who view this secondarily, if you could come up to the mic and speak into the mic if you have a question. Obviously the folks up here already have their microphones, but that way we can get the question on record and then hear the response on record as well. So that's the only request I would have.
Hi, my name's Lance Fenna. I've got a question, a few points. Let's say there's an open meeting going on and all of a sudden, you know, they're holding their hand over the mic, people are talking, running around, whispering, and people in the open meeting cannot hear what's going on. That's one instance. Or if something comes up and there's frantic typing on their iPad over here, and then all of a sudden over here someone, oh, I see this, and then they speak. You know, obviously they're communicating electronically, you know, during an open meeting. Is that correct and allowable? And my second question would be, should they have a designated records custodian, because I have asked open records, and it seems like by the time I get the open records, it's went through several people. You know, does this just get handed around and then it finally comes to me? You know, sometimes that's not very professional. So, you know, what's your take on that?
Yeah, I'll answer your first question about the electronic transmissions during a meeting with another example. That happened in actually the city of Madison a few years ago, where there was a meeting of a city council or subcommittee or something like that, and there was a reporter sitting there who could see that their members were texting. And so he made an open records request for all the texts, because text messages are subject to the law. And he got them, and he could tell that there were things that were relevant to what was being discussed at the meeting that were being texted about during the meeting, and that was a no-no. You know, everything that goes on in the meeting is supposed to be on display to anybody watching the meeting. But that's why, you know, even having an email conversation that's not noticed will be a violation of the open meetings law. Information gathering is a governmental activity. So if you're getting a text from your buddy on the other side of the council chamber about what's being discussed, you know, that should all be happening in the public eye. So that would be a concern. You know, there can be, as to like covering the microphones, I don't know, it would need to relate to governmental business if it were, you know, can you pick my daughter up from soccer practice tomorrow? I can't be there because I got to work. You know, I don't have as much of a problem with that as somebody were to say, are you going to vote no on this thing? I'm really concerned about X, Y, or Z. That would kind of get you in the realm of sort of the texting stuff. Then your other question was about records custodians. I can hand that off to John.
And so your question was, you felt like the records that you had requested had passed through several hands before they got to you?
Right.
And why did that concern you?
When asking, it's like there was no one that was really a designated records custodian. And then finally when someone said, well, I can get that, well, then it went through and it was emailed to me by, you know, other people. You know, it just didn't seem like it was a direct, I asked for this, and this is what I got from, you know.
Actually, in relation to that, then, how could you be sure you got what you really asked for if it went through so many people? Were they consistent?
Right. And, you know, I have lived in rural Fort Atkinson, and I've lived in Jefferson for about 20 years now, and so I do have a great sympathy for how small towns and small town boards, township boards, I should say, and county supervisors, how they deal with requests like this. And, you know, I might have been joking about the subcommittee that dealt with the landscaping at the school board, but, you know, if I were on that committee and I got faced with an open records request, I'm kind of blindsided. I've received no training in it. I don't know whether I should be able to hand things out. I don't know what to look for. You know, as our fearless leader at the council often says, you know, he's in the decades that he's worked as an investigative journalist and brushed up against people who work in government or who've been appointed to government boards from high to low, most of them, all of them, you know, there's very few bad apples out there, and they don't spoil the rest of the bunch, and their heart is in the right place, and they do want to respond to a request like this. But it is a matter of education, and that's why we're here. And so if there's a bit of a delay or if there's some uncertainty, I guess I wouldn't be surprised in some cases. You know, when it comes down to the rubber meeting the road, yes, you're right. You know, you can only hope that they did respond with all of the records that met your request. And sometimes you may need to try again or try again from a different angle if you have some suspicions. It can be dangerous because you get down into conspiracy theory territory at some points, it feels like, when you believe that something exists and everyone says that it doesn't. So I would have some sympathy for the people that you're requesting records from. And yes, they might need to be reminded of who the custodian could be. As I said, at the lowest level, the chair of a committee is the first authority who holds the records for that committee. But also, Lance, I would like to say I am enough of a nerd of open records and open meetings that it is a pleasure to meet you. I believe I nominated you for an OPI at one point, and I've used you as an anecdote and used the school board of Milton as an anecdote in several cases because of the remarkable thing that you set in motion. Number one, Lance went to a school board meeting with his video camera. I don't know if my mental image is correct, but I do picture an old big VHS recorder that sits on your shoulder. and you started recording the meeting, and this made some of the school board members uncomfortable, and they decided to adjourn the meeting early. And they very quickly learned that they were in the wrong about that, and it was a good learning experience for them because, and I applaud the school board, by the very next meeting, they were recording the meetings on their own and live streaming them on the internet. And that warms my heart in so many ways.
Chime in on that, say job well done. And then as to the custodian, sometimes they do need to designate a custodian who is the proper person to receive the request. It's like state agency websites, you'll very frequently, you know, there'll be a banner or something for open records requests and you can know who to go to. You know, there's some things in the rules and in the statute about, you know, if it's a committee, ask the chair. If it's an elected official, the elected official is responsible, but they can designate somebody as a custodian. So it gets a little bit technical, but it sometimes. But one thing that custodians are supposed to do is post a policy for open records procedures, and maybe that would also be a place to look, whether here or somewhere else, so people will know where to go.
Any questions? As well?
We can just repeat it too into the mic if anyone wants to shout one out.
Actually, I have a question about, you want me to come?
Sure.
I'm not really going to really shake.
And you had your hand up in the back as well.
I'm just wondering about the one person for a custodian that Chris answered.
Oh, okay.
Go ahead.
Okay, my name is Terry Fenna, and I have a question about minutes. And I'm not sure, I know there's minutes on county, city, town, school, they're different levels, and I know there's this thing about minutes in the newspaper now that they're talking about possibly not publishing them. And I looked at some minutes tonight at one of the meetings, I won't say which or whose, that it says a certain topic and that's it. It didn't say anything about it. And I wondered how that relates to you telling us that like maybe an agenda or subject item should be enough to give people information about what's going on. Because if these minutes aren't going to be in the newspaper, and if people don't have access to the computer, looking at those minutes are not going to tell anyone anything. It simply has two words.
Okay. That's a very interesting question. I would rephrase it as saying that it really has two parts. The first being the question of what needs to be in the minutes and what are the minutes. And the second is about a suggestion that has come up a few times in the last few years and that has been announced that it could be part of the next state budget, that they would make some changes about the way that some legal records could be published. And that has a very precise meaning, but I'll talk about that one second. The minutes should be a reflection of what you saw on the agenda. And the statutes, I believe, are really quite bare about what is required to be in the minutes. I believe, correct me if I'm wrong, but you simply, the most minimum amount of information that you need to have in the minutes is the vote that you took on anything that you said where you were going to take action. And to the credit of the many governmental bodies that I see, I think that the quality of minutes has gotten better in the last decade or two than it was before. The clerk, the secretary that's there, is often really explaining what happened. They weren't required to by statute, but you can find the minutes of the meetings that really do have quite a bit of information written down about what happened. So again, I say the minutes are a mirror of what happened on the agenda. You want the agenda to be reasonably specific about what's going to happen. Is this agenda item simply discussing something? Is it something that we're going to take a vote on? Now, if there was a vote taken, that's the one thing that's required to be in the minutes, but the rest is kind of regarded as gravy by the statutes. I don't think the statutes really say. And court cases are probably just making recommendations if someone had complained about the quality of the minutes. Now, that is something that you can simply encourage your favorite governmental entity to improve, and I think they do.
And is that something that if you had a question about it, you would have to go through the records request to maybe get something if, say, like you weren't in attendance?
Well, and I agree, okay. And I think this is something that where more elaborate minutes benefit that government entity as much as they benefit the public. If you have something that explains what happened at the meeting, you're not going to be asked questions one-on-one from every citizen who's concerned about that. You do want lots of documentation about what you do. It's a record for yourself as well. If you have someone on a board or a committee who's not there, they want something to review about what happened as well. So it benefits everybody involved. Now, for the second half of your question about public notices and how they can be published, I was digging into this the other day. I found a couple of news stories that talked about the proposals that have been put forward. I didn't find anything that was specific about the language that was going to be put into the budget, so I don't know exact details yet. But the concern is, I would hope and believe that some government entities have complained to their legislators to say that the cost of publishing things in the newspaper that they are required to publish. Now, this could include legal notices, it could include meeting minutes. Again, that's why I wanted to see the exact language before I would say exactly what it was that they're asking to now put online instead of the newspaper of record. So a moment ago, we were talking about who is the records custodian for the city, for example. Well, at your kickoff meeting for every new year of council members, when you swear everyone in, part of what I'm sure you do is to designate the paper of record for your city, and then everyone knows when you look at the minutes from that meeting, I can go to the courier to find anything legal that the city publishes. So I would believe that this came into play because government entities asked to begin to reduce that cost. Presumably it would be cheaper for them to put those notices online on their city website instead of having to have them published in the newspaper. And I sympathize with your opinion that this may be more difficult for people. I know I'm in IT and I think about broadband issues across the state. And I know if you Google a Wisconsin broadband map, you can see that there's 60 or 70% of the state where you might not have cell coverage to be able to use a smartphone to get on the internet. And if you can get any form of land-based internet, it may only be a megabit per second or two, which is a 20th of what you might get from Charter if you have cable in the city. So I think that there are some issues of access there that I hope they address. To me, I think there's still some cost involved with the city putting things on their website. There's questions of how long those records would stay there. There's questions of in what form is that information? Is it searchable? Is it just as easy and convenient? Is it more convenient? There's going to be reasons for this and against this, and I hope those get discussed. If some of this is meeting minutes and agendas, I think there's questions for that. If it's other forms of legal notice that most of us aren't interested in, I would say, perhaps the attorneys are more interested in some types of notices than others. Land speculators are interested in notices of foreclosures. Where is all of that going to be published? I don't know why the question hasn't been suggested that, or should the solution be suggested that the state would provide a unified central location to do this, but then that would create a state expense as opposed to the state being able to push this back down to cities.
I just wanted to make a comment regarding the minutes, because that's been, there's been confusion and disagreement just among our elected officials about minutes, and not only our minutes, but different governmental body minutes. So we send our clerk to training every year, and she's trained on the established best practices that the clerks across the state are trained on. And we encourage her to implement those best practices, but there is, like you said, the statute isn't specific, so their organization has determined what the best practices are, and I'm wondering if you've ever been able to attend those trainings or give feedback. I mean, I know they're open to anybody to go to, but if that's something that you have done or have any experience in what the actual organization of the clerks determines as best practice.
I've been to like county like corporation council ones. I haven't been to the clerk's ones specifically. But yeah, I know a lot of governmental entities just follow Robert's Rules of Order, and they have their own practices. And so, you know, I think that is helpful because the statute is so bare bones, but I don't have any particular knowledge about what they say. And then I have a point about notices, but I'll let John, do you have anything to chime in on minutes?
No, not really. I haven't been to a Clerks Association meeting. I've been to the Department of Justice day-long seminars that they've held, and a lot of clerks came to that. I know our Jefferson County clerk came along with me to go to that. As you say, you know, the Clerks Association, I think, you know, they do a good job on keeping clerks up on all sorts of best practices for everything that they do, including the open records, open meetings side of things. But there is a lot of other things that they have to focus on, so I can't imagine that they spend a lot of time talking about open records, open meetings issues. And the other part of it is that there's a lot of clerks who don't get to go to that Wisconsin Clerk Association meetings that you mentioned too.
Yeah. So would you recommend additional training? Because you're not sure if they provide our clerk with enough training.
I just don't know one way or the other.
I don't really know one way. All right. Thanks.
Yeah. You know, and also, of course, so many meetings are recorded. That really helps people to access what happened at the meeting. There are questions of how long those meetings can be archived, like the video recordings of the meetings. How long are those retained? Whereas minutes, you know, have a little bit less storage space than saving a video. One thing that we do encourage on the council, though, is when you have, if you're recording your meeting, that you also record the closed session, so that if there is a dispute later on about what happened at the closed session and whether it was actually a proper closed session, or if there was a issue about it, that those could be then reviewed at a later time. And that's something they actually require by law in other states like Illinois.
So there isn't a statute in our state to record closed sessions, though?
Not currently. Okay. No, not currently. And then as to notices, John mentioned having a centralized place where all notices could be reviewed and things that are published in the papers. There actually is a website that does that right now, and it is available through the Wisconsin Newspaper Association. You can go online, and for any county, for any newspaper, for any part of the state, you can search the newspaper notices and see them as they were printed at the time. And that's really handy. I think it's called Take Notice Wisconsin. Do you know, John?
Don't remember the website.
Yeah, but you can also go through the Wisconsin Newspaper Association website, but it's really useful. You know, if you're looking for something from a couple of years ago, and it's a really good historic electronic summary of the historic record that will, you know, presumably also be retained in like the Historical Society archive someday. But for now, you can get all that stuff online, and it's really useful. Question.
Still on the minutes. I'm sorry, but. Your suggestion is a little more information is good for both the board and the public. So I'll give you an example. I'll give you an agenda item. You tell me the bare minimum minutes after that agenda item. Public comments. What's the bare minimum for the minutes?
What I've seen a lot is a list of who commented and just a sentence or two summary of what they said. Very common. I don't, the most recent example I can think of is the Wisconsin Natural Resources Board. That's what they do. They have a public comment session and they usually summarize what who spoke and what they said, just briefly.
I would note that that is an issue that I've looked at in the past. Public comment as an agenda item is not required. It's purely a decision of that entity, that board that's meeting. For some things, right? There are public hearings that are a different matter altogether when laws are coming into creation. But public comment at, let's say, a city council meeting is at their discretion. You know, and they can put their own rules in place that, for example, I know in Fort Atkinson, they have a rule. For many years, they didn't have any public comment. When they did decide to allow public comment, they only allowed people who live in Fort Atkinson or who own property in Fort Atkinson to be able to speak. And I thought that was unfair because let's say that Fort Atkinson conducts some kind of annexation operation in the future where there's some citizens who live next door to Fort Atkinson who are going to be pulled into the city. They could not actually speak at the city council when they take that action, for example. Now, you're right, it would be nice if public comment was recorded. But, you know, they'll often limit you to only discussing things that are before them on that agenda, for example. They may limit you in time. They may reserve the right to cut you off at any time.
I guess my question is, what is responder required to be on the minutes?
Absolutely nothing.
Public comment,
as far as I know.
Minutes you don't have to put in.
That's correct.
Sorry. But it would be videotaped. So it's not like they can erase the videotape, right?
Now, the recording of meetings is another issue near and dear to my heart. For several years, I was the president of the Wisconsin Community Media, which is the state association of all of the PEG channels throughout the state, all of the public, educational, and governmental channels, the public access channels, the channels that were the people who were doing the recordings of public meetings. And so, yes, I think it's great when meetings get recorded that way. It becomes another way to preserve exactly what happened at the meeting. And as Krista mentioned, one of the things that we recommend on our legislative wish list is that meetings would get recorded at least on audio, and especially that part that was the closed session, so that if there ever was any controversy about what happened or what could have been discussed in closed session or whether they did follow the rules when they were in closed session, that could be reviewed by a judge in private as the issue was being evaluated.
One comment that I would make about the meeting minutes, especially in regards to the public comments, from a clerk's perspective, one of the difficulties that they have is they cannot write down verbatim what you say. It's almost impossible to transcribe it exactly what you'd say, and if you did so, it would make the meeting minutes incredibly long. So there's an element of discretion and there's an element of subjectivity in there. And what I have seen is when somebody says, well, I don't agree with that, or I really like that, and then it gets put down in the meeting minutes is as so-and-so citizen is in support of. I didn't say I was in support of it, I just said I liked it. And so that level of subjectivity makes clerks a little leery about trying to paraphrase things. So that's why, at the end of the day, recording meetings are the best. Because then you get an exact, verbatim, non-deniable situation in which someone has spoken, and their words are verbatim from their own voice. So I understand the frustration with meeting minutes, but that's just a perspective. Coming from a different organization before I came here, for 11 years that switched on the agenda over and over, who could speak, what they could speak about, how long they could speak. Sometimes it was at the front of the agenda, sometimes it was at the end of the agenda. For a number of years they split it on matters which could be affected by council action was at the beginning of the agenda, and matters which cannot be affected by council action was at the end of the agenda. So it varies all over the place. And being the only person in the room who's worked for multiple communities, I can tell you it varies all over the place. So there's not one perfect way to do it. There are better ways and there are worse ways, but yeah.
And I guess I'd toss a question back to you as well. At least for the council members, they have that opportunity when you're approving the minutes to review or adjust the language, at least in terms of the way that they were represented or the way an issue was represented. And how often does that happen?
Well, infrequently, I'll use that. Again, a subjective term, infrequently. Yeah. But you are exactly right. Every time the minutes are approved at every agenda, and oftentimes in the city of Milton, the agenda is approved as well.
I took minutes for lots of years, and there's two issues. First, the one when I used to take it, and we had like a closed session or executive session, and that's back in the shorthand days, I would go in and take minutes for the executive session that was not public. It did not go out, but it was a record. The other thing is for the public comments, I can understand where, okay, there's public comments on the agenda, and lots of times places say there were no public comments. But then what if there was? You know, I feel like you should say three people spoke on this topic, or, you know, just something instead of just seeing that in the minutes where you don't know if anyone did, or there could have been 20 and you don't, you know, and maybe it's either here or there, but.
Well, you know, I'd suggest that if someone did have an opinion about an issue and they thought enough about it to come and speak at a council meeting, it would also be good to provide that information in writing. And then those records could be requested by someone who is curious. You know, if there was an issue that came up in your city and you could go to the city clerk and say, I'd like to see all of the public comment that you've received on that particular issue in this time period. Tell me about all the people who were talking about the ethanol plant in the last 60 days. Reasonably specific, you've got a time period. They could provide you with copies of those emails or the letters that they received about that issue. And I would hope that people would do that too, because then there's a record. If you come to a meeting and speak, you're relying on those who write the history books. And for that matter, Mr. City Administrator, I think the people who write the agendas also control the game to a certain extent, too. Who's allowed to put agenda items on there? What's the actual question put on the agenda? What's discussed in the general meeting that you have before the public meeting? Things like that. There's lots of ways that things can be controlled and spun. But
hey, let's say they're all in a closed session.
Couldn't hear what you said.
Do you want to come forward?
The question is, if a council member makes a record during a closed session, is the question whether that's a document? Can you make your own record?
Yes.
Sure. Anybody can make their own record.
Their own recording or whatever they want to do.
Their own recording? You probably should make the rest of the committee aware of it.
Okay, so if the microphone is laying on the table and everybody can see it, that's pretty much a notice or not?
I don't know. I'd have to. That's not a situation that I have encountered before.
How about when they go off agenda in a closed meeting, and then there's a recording being made of that?
You know, that's getting a little bit into the weeds, because it's not exactly a meetings issue, because there's no requirement to record it, and it could be a records issue if somebody were ever to record it. Or request that recording, but it's a little bit outside the scope of the meetings and records laws. I will say that, you know, like getting back to the beginning of this discussion, you know, the open records and open meetings laws are about access to information and the public knowing what's going on and democracy. And my bias is that more information is better. When we were litigating the City of Milton ethanol plant case in 2006, 2007, I think one reason we were able to know what the city had discussed at these closed sessions where the ethanol plant was an issue was because somebody kept executive session closed or minutes. And, you know, that was helpful for everybody to be on the same level playing field about what happened.
How about a good frontier would be let's get this legislatively required to make that record.
Legislation?
That takes it all off from their shoulders.
That's exactly, the comment is that if it's better if this was just handled by the legislature, you know, we agree, and then it's uniform across the state, everyone knows what they've got to do, it could avoid a lot of disputes later on, whether, you know, by somebody who thought something shouldn't have been discussed in closed session, and, you know, maybe they're wrong, maybe it wasn't, and, or if there was something that was improperly discussed in closed session or some other issue, then that can be verified that, you know, that was an error. So
that would indeed clean it up a lot.
I think it would, yeah. So there's, you know, some legislation that was circulated about that a few years ago. I think they're trying to revive that again this year. Hopefully it gets somewhere. Tell your legislator.
Who is it in the legislation that's against these? I mean, they tried to make the open records more secretive and more restrictive not all that long ago and changed the open records law. So where is that coming from?
You're right. A few years ago, there was an effort over right before 4th of July weekend to gut the open records law through the budget. And just beware that this is another budget year. Everyone, keep an eye on things. And it was done at the last minute, and it was done after any opportunity for public comment had occurred. It was just the most shameful, cowardly attack on the open records law I've ever seen. And that, I think it was determined, came from the assembly leadership. And who else was involved? It was Voss, Robin Voss.
It came out in the form of what they call a motion 999, which is kind of an omnibus, let's clean up all the crumbs from the table and put it into law motion at the end of the budget process through the Joint Finance Committee. And they brought this forward on, I think it was a Friday afternoon before the 4th of July weekend. And all of the Finance Committee members claimed that they did not know where it came from. They all voted to approve it.
The Republicans.
And
not all of them.
And it would have gutted a tremendous amount of the power of the transparency of government. It would allow them to not have to release any records that had anything to do with the creation of a law, for example, any of the draft, a draft bill. You would only see the law in its final form, and you wouldn't be able to investigate any records about how it was created. They wanted to exempt communications between legislators. They wanted to exempt communications between legislators and their staff. They wanted to exempt all records that had anything to do with that deliberation process for new laws or executive action. It really would have tied the hands of journalists, or for that matter, citizens who wanted to see what was going on. But the response, from the journalists was very strong and very rapid. Even the response from the Republican Attorney General, he opposed it.
And the public.
And the public certainly opposed it. Thousands of letters and emails were sent that weekend. By Sunday night or Monday morning, they had pulled back. But it did take an above-the-fold, full-page editorial on the Milwaukee Journal, which they hardly ever do, for example, to make that happen. And that's what inspired us to do the nine-city roadshow, for example. Legislators don't like it when the press reports on, in particular, who was communicating with them that inspired them to create a particular bit of legislation, and they wanted to do away with them.
So you said that the Department of Justice could make a recommendation or a ruling on something or an opinion? Is that was one of the avenues that you listed before?
Yeah.
There are these opinions of the Attorney General, which, as I would understand it, don't follow, they don't hold any weight of law or of court precedent, but they are an opinion from the Attorney General on some of the issues that may not have been resolved very clearly by the courts or by the law. So, for example, I think, you know, the recommendation that you respond within 10 working days is that sort of a recommendation from the Attorney General.
Mm-hmm. So has he made any recommendations on recording closed sessions or any opinions on that?
I don't think so. This has been on our council wish list for a while, and as Krista said, you know, it is what they do in Illinois. Is that right, mm-hmm. for example?
So we could ask for an opinion on it, or you don't?
You could certainly ask for an opinion on it. That would be a great step forward. I also would say, I mean, I'm not an attorney, but I would say that there's no reason that you couldn't start doing it.
Right.
You know, on one hand, you're taking a step forward. You are simultaneously protecting yourself as to what happened in closed session if it ever becomes controversial.
So how do we, I guess I would feel more
comfortable. But if you did something wrong, you're exposing yourself to risk.
If we got an opinion on it, I would rather have an opinion. So,
right.
So we could just contact them and ask them for their opinion on it.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But I will note, they'll only tell you what the open meetings law and open records law requires. And, you know, frankly, that neither law requires recording closed sessions right now, which is why we're trying to get a legislative solution to that. So the opinion may not tell you much other than, you know, it's not required. It might be a good idea. It's up to you. And so that gets back to John's point that, you know, nothing's stopping you from doing it now.
And so you don't recommend getting an opinion from them on most things then?
What could he say? I mean, he could tell you what the law is. And as Krista says, it's not the law now. So I don't think he could give you a recommendation one way or the other. To explain it a little bit more to the public, I mean, when Krista was talking about the reasons that a governmental body can go into closed session, they're listed very specifically in the law. You're not supposed to discuss other matters when you're in closed session. And that's when things get controversial. The law doesn't say much, and I know I'm treading into very Milton territory here, but the law doesn't say much about information that could leak out of a closed session. But that's usually what happens that causes some controversy. You went into closed session because you said you were going to be talking about employee relations and you ended up talking about hiring coaches. If you've strayed from the allowable reason that you can go into closed session, it can cause public controversy. And so that's what you're trying to avoid. You know, I don't want to get into tinfoil hat territory, but, you know, I know that I've seen closed sessions where I strongly suspect or had inside knowledge from a buddy on the council who said that, yeah, we ended up talking about something else and we really shouldn't have done that, but it was hard to rein everybody in, and then eventually we got back on track. Well, you know, everybody's heart was in the right place, but they didn't follow the letter of the law. How big of an issue was it? Was it something that involved a great deal of public money or not? That's whether it would ever become a legal controversy.
Whose responsibility is it to rein it back in then if it's getting out of control?
I don't know. Do city councils always listen to their attorney?
If the attorney's in the meeting. Yeah. The question was whose responsibility is to get the meeting back on track onto the noticed issue. I mean, I think that always rests with the chair, but you know, if the attorney is in there or somebody else, they could, anybody can step up and do that, obviously, whether you're a chairman, a member of the committee or whatever. So,
yeah, I would say like 98% of the time we have our attorney in closed session, but there's been a couple of times when
100% of the time that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think there was only one closed session that I've ever been in that our attorney hasn't. Mm-hmm. been there and been present. So, I mean, that's something that we feel more comfortable with having our attorney there than not when we're conducting closed sessions.
No, that can help.
Unless you think they're not good to have in there. Is that what your recommendation is not to have an attorney?
I don't exactly have a recommendation either way. The one of the exemptions to closed session, to open session, is specifically to meet with your attorney about litigation in which you are involved or you expected to become involved. So clearly they need to be in there for that one. And then, you know, anything else, you know, that if their advice is needed, you know, then they would probably be a good idea to have them in the session as well. I will say too that, you know, John, I didn't have at the end of my PowerPoint about the open meetings law, that there is an enforcement provision, but there is, just like there is in the open records law, And that's where some of these things end up. And there's remedies for when things go wrong, as many people here know. But you know, these issues are being litigated across the state right now, including last week in the Wisconsin Supreme Court with the Appleton School District. So anyway, thanks for the invitation. If there's no other questions.
One more,
yes, go for it. I have a question, please. And this is with regard to when confidential information is released from an open records request. Is there a requirement that that person has to keep the confidentiality of the information that they have collected?
I mean, if a record is released that accidentally contains some confidential information, what is the obligation of the person who receives it?
Right.
You know, that's not something that's spelled out in the open records law. And, you know, depending on what the information is, different people may handle it differently. But typically, it's mostly on the custodian to make sure it doesn't get out in the first place. Okay. But again, it's not addressed in the law that I can think of.
So if it's accidentally released by the custodian, then the custodian could be sued for releasing that confidential information?
You know, that's not an open records question either, because if it's it might be a question depending on what other laws involved about the confidentiality, say, you know, like a medical record or something like that, or a student pupil record, or, you know, it's going to depend on those laws and not the open records laws.
So then my other question is, when you're talking about meeting notices, even in the situation where you're talking about personnel, is it appropriate to be specific on that agenda?
It depends. Again, you know, you'll need to be more specific. What you absolutely cannot do is only state the exemption that you're relying on, as stated in the open meetings laws. You've got to be more specific. You can't just repeat that exemption that's in the statute. That's been made clear in a number of attorney general opinions. And then how specific you get beyond that, again, the law requires reasonable notice so that the public can be reasonably likely to be apprised about the subject matter of the closed session.
Are you asking in particular about whether you should name names?
Yes, because as you know, some closed sessions are that involves city personnel, or even more recently for us, it was somebody on council. So that's what my question is.
I don't think I've ever heard of anything that said that you had to name names. Is that correct?
I don't know that that's addressed one way or the other in the open records law or open meetings law.
It would have only been in court precedent.
Yeah.
Yeah, right.
Yes, we have recently been told that as council people, we cannot attend committee meetings that we are not on. Now, even though the agenda is printed and it says that there could be a quorum of council people there, and the council people that do come to the meeting don't vote, or they just come to listen to what's being discussed, how is that illegal? Why is that classified as open meeting? Now, this came from the district or the general or whoever from up in Madison.
Right.
But we as council people can't attend a committee meeting if we're not on the committee.
It was creating a quorum. Some of our committees are a quorum already. Mm-hmm. So it wasn't something that had to do with us specifically. Al, did you want to talk a little bit about it?
What she's referring to, and I'm sure you're probably aware of it, was the opinion handed down by the Attorney General that a quorum of the council shall not be present at a meeting that that the council does not serve on. So a subcommittee meeting or something of that nature, a quorum of the council cannot be present at that meeting if they're not an actual member of that committee. And that was the opinion handed down by the Department of Justice Attorney General. We had our attorney review it, and as I guess I don't want to put words in his mouth, he reiterated that that to the council that that is the attorney, that is the opinion of the Attorney General. And as you said, it doesn't carry any weight of law, but that was the opinion that came from the Department of Justice. Mm-hmm. So that's what she's referring to. So we're struggling with here at the local level of, we have several committees. We've got tourism committee, we've got the fire commission, and council members want to attend those meetings to see firsthand what is happening at those meetings. But based on that opinion by the Attorney General, they've indicated that a quorum of the council shall not be present at those meetings, even if they're not a member of that committee and they're simply just sitting in the audience.
Mm-hmm. I've not reviewed that opinion. But what I'm aware of is a Supreme Court case called the Vodke case from, I don't remember how many years ago it was, but it basically said that as long as you notice the fact that a quorum of another governmental body could be there, then, you know, that's what you need to do, is you just need to notice it. And it sounds like that's being done. I don't know what the specific rationale for the Attorney General, the Assistant Attorney General's opinion was on that. But, you know, I don't know why a member who of the council would have less rights than anybody else in the community to attend a meeting of another city body.
Well, it's always been posted on the bottom of the agenda that there could be a quorum of council people there. So that's why I just wondered why it's considered illegal.
That's an interesting opinion, and I haven't read it either. And I know that, again, I'm familiar with the workings of government at the small and rural level, and I have great sympathy for this. To give an example of the confusion that can happen with issues like this, imagine that you were a committee of five overseeing a particular issue for your city, whether it be citizen-appointed people or a couple members of your council. So you've got five people on the committee. Three people can make a quorum. There's a concept of a negative quorum. There's the number of people that it would take to block a particular action of that committee. So that would only be two people. So if two people were meeting and talking about what that five-person committee is doing, they're actually working illegally in the sense that they're violating the open meetings law, because they could block an action by voting against it. If three people of that five committee show up, you have a quorum, you can hold a meeting, and those two people colluded outside of the meeting to have that. Now, it gets super ridiculous when you have a committee of three people. In theory, you can't even talk to yourself.
And that's kind of what that opinion was getting at,
right,
too. And it wasn't that they couldn't attend, but it had to be noticed that a joint meeting was going to take place. So we would have to essentially, because almost our entire council was showing up to every committee meeting, we would have to start just having five or six council meetings a month because they were all showing up. So it would be a dual meeting with that committee and the council.
The rationale, as I understand it, is just to let the public know that the quorum of a different governmental body could be getting information, which is probably what happens since they're not members of that other committee. But I'd have to look at it. I'm sorry, I haven't reviewed it ahead of time, and I can't comment on what else the Attorney General might have been thinking about. But, you know, as a matter of, it wouldn't bother me personally as long as it's noticed for other council members to show up.
So if we decide to ignore an opinion by the Attorney General and then we go to court and we're sued and we lose and they say, well, your attorney recommended that you follow the opinion, you didn't, or whatever, I mean, does that make it worse for us then if we go against several attorneys' recommendations?
That's getting into legal advice for me, and yeah. I can't do that.
Okay, so she can't do that, but I guess I could field it. I mean, to me, it's the opinions of the Attorney General are not law. So I don't think that you could get in trouble for not following one.
We can just follow whatever ones we want, then?
No, you're still following the law. You're providing notice that those people could be present, and no one could argue with that. because that's the law, but.
It came from a complaint that was filed, so.
Right. I'll dig into that one when I get home.
That would be great. Let us know.
I'm also very surprised that I haven't heard more email questions. Doesn't anyone have a question about texting or emailing, or does anyone here have a private email server?
We're not that stupid.
Have your own wireless account or own router?
Yes, your own secret router somewhere.
Just with the minutes thing, I mean, I took minutes for the county meeting sometimes, but all of the county where you're talking five, the quorum, would have people come, other county supervisors would come in as a citizen. We would be noting that when we did our minutes, present, and then under citizens, we would put their name as, but they, and they could ask question as a citizen, but there was no actions or anything or inter-discussion.
County board members also do that so they can get the per diem for showing up at the meeting. Right.
But, we don't run on a per diem basis, thank goodness.
And, you know, having sat in many meetings like that at the county or the city level, it really does come back to who's running the meeting and how they run the discussion, because sometimes those discussions get so informal. You've got five people on the committee, there's three other county board members there who are sitting in, and everybody's talking out of turn, and you've lost Robert Rules of Order, and you're right. It can get a bit blurred.
We had the chairman who would say, no, we cannot, or, right. You know, they could.
If that person's not a member of the committee and they haven't been invited to speak, then you're right. Shouldn't they be treated as the public?
Right.
And they had a moment at public comment, if there even was one, mm-hmm. or if a member of the committee did say, I'd like to let this person speak in my stead. Mm-hmm. But they get more informal than that, don't they?
So one thing we can do on the Attorney General letter that you mentioned is we can bring it up at our next council meeting, which would be in April. So we'll definitely raise that as having been a concern, and maybe the council collectively will have some better thoughts from you, especially once we've actually read this. So
oftentimes it's been my experience that our attorney will make recommendations on elected officials on various committees or council or commissions just disagree, and I'm not even talking about this one specifically, but have just knowingly just said, well, we're not going to follow that law. And so I wonder, I mean, to me, I feel a little bit nervous about always saying to the attorney that we know better when we don't have law degrees. So I'm wondering what your experience has been with councils not following, or commissions or committees not following the attorney's recommendation.
Generally speaking, I can't think of a lot of situations where that has occurred. I think one of the biggest issues is when sometimes for attorneys is when they're not asked in the first place about a particular issue. But, you know, attorneys need education on open records and public meetings laws just like everybody else does. It's not really an answer, but I also have to get going in a few minutes. So.
I guess as someone who's not an attorney, I would also say in my experience, sometimes attorneys are wrong. Sometimes DAs are wrong.
All
of your opposing counsel are wrong. and so, yeah, it can be hard for the average small town attorney to stay abreast of all this too, you know. It's there can be issues where there's some controversy. So if there wasn't any more, Krista says she needs to get back to Madison.
Mm-hmm. Gotta work on a brief tonight.
Oh boy.
Well, thank you.
All right.
Thank you very much.
We'd like to thank you as well. We appreciate the outreach. We appreciate the request that you'd like to hear more about what we do and that you're interested in these questions. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks for your interest.